Hello and welcome to the new episodes of Epigenetic Lecture Series. Central dogma of molecular biology remained the backbone of molecular and biochemical research for decades. It describes a two-step process for the flow of information within living systems. This was first proposed by Francis and Crick in 1958. According to the model, genetic information is written in the form of orderly arranged sequences of nucleotides, or DNA. The DNA form new copies of DNA through a process called DNA replication, and in this way, it ensures the perpetuation of information to newly formed daughter nuclei. Certain specific information from DNA is transcribed in the form of RNA, which is a single stranded molecule and carry potential information for the making of proteins. This process is called transcription. Ribosomal machinery produces proteins based on the information written in RNA transcripts, and eventually proteins perform various activities in the cell and determine phenotype of the cell. According to the model, this whole process is unidirectional and no opposite flow of information is possible. So, according to the model, phenotype of the cell is entirely dependent on its genotype. However, recent advances in the field of molecular biology has highlighted some defects in the model, and some of the processes in living systems has been seen to violate the principle, thus challenging the central dogmatic view of this model. Today we know that DNA can not only make new copies of DNA through replication, sometimes it can also direct the formation of protein, that is the translation process, without making an intermediate RNA molecule. This has been observed in case of E. coli cells living in cell-free environment. Similarly, retroviruses like HIV can make complementary copy of DNA and incorporate it to host genome. So this is a reverse process of transcription. These viruses contain enzyme called reverse transcriptase. RNA-dependent RNA polymerase enzymes can make new copies of RNA from an existing copy. This is called RNA replication, and it has been observed in many organisms including eukaryotes. As a result of this process, small RNA molecules called non-coding RNAs, microRNAs are formed that result in target RNA or gene silencing. Similarly, some small protein peptides called prions have been shown to carry structural information and can impart conformational changes to other proteins carrying the same sequence. So, this is phenotype-to-phenotype inheritance. All these observations violate central dogma of molecular biology and questions genotype as a sole determinant of phenotype or inheritance. Monozygotic twin studies may provide an estimate of the relative contribution of genetic and non-genetic factors to a specific phenotype. They are considered genetically identical, but significant phenotypic discordance between them may exist. I am sure we all have met such twins at least once in our life. Monozygotic twins, unlike dizygotic twins, originate from a single fertilized cell or zygote, thus have 100% same genetic makeup. Among other commonalities like age and sex, monozygotes are also attached to the same placenta and share a common uterus and early life environment, whereas unrelated individuals have almost nothing in common. That is why they are all different from each other. On the other hand, despite having so much similarities, there are phenotypic variations even among monozygotic twins. This quality is particularly noticeable for psychiatric diseases such as schizophrenia and bipolar disorders. Monozygotic twins have been used to demonstrate the role of environmental factors in determining complex diseases and phenotypes. But the true nature of the phenotypic discordance nevertheless remain extremely poorly understood. Epigenetic differences may be an important part of the solution to this puzzle. Branch of epigenetics deals with those forms of inheritance that do not involve the change in primary DNA sequence, and proposes some alternate mechanisms for phenotype determination as well as inheritance. Some of the recent studies investigated global and locus-specific differences of DNA methylation and histone modification. In a cohort of 40 identical twins aged 3 to 74 years, the authors concluded that there is age-dependent epigenetic drift observed in these monozygotes. In fact, it makes sense that there should be an increasing number of dissimilar epigenetic changes in the aging co-twins. In the given figure, age at disease onset and concordance rate of monozygotic twins from aforementioned studies are plotted. The x-axis represent age in years, whereas y-axis shows percentage concordance among twins. The left and right margins of each shape represent the range of age of onset, and upper and lower margins represent the lower and the greatest concordance rates of each disease. Each shape is representing a complex disorder like autism, celiac disease, schizophrenia, Kahn's disease, asthma, diabetes mellitus 1, diabetes mellitus 2, Alzheimer's disease, breast cancer, ulcerative disease, multiple sclerosis, etc. Cleft lip and palate occurs during embryogenesis and therefore are placed to the left of the graph. It is obvious from the picture that even monozygotes are discordant for the age of onset for any particular disease mentioned in this study. It is also interesting to note that monozygotes are also discordant for the cleft lip and palate disease, provided the fact that they are sharing the same uterus environment. These observations suggest that in some cases, epigenetic phenotypic differences in monozygotic twins are possible without any specific environmental cause. It is also important to note that the degree of twin discordance for various complex diseases does not necessarily correlate with the age of onset. For example, concordance of Alzheimer's disease, which manifests predominantly in the 8th decade of life, can be as high as 83%, whereas concordance rates for early onset, that is first and second decade disease, such as diabetes mellitus 1, can be as low as 32%. In a study, Fraga et al. Investigated age-related differences in the DNA methylations and histone modifications among monozygotes. Global DNA methylation signatures were produced using global methylation DNA fingerprinting technique called AIMS, amplification of intermethylated sites. The geographical distribution of DNA methylation differences within the chromosomes of monozygotic twins were established by competitive hybridization of AIMS PCR products to metaphase chromosomes. The AIMS product from one of the twins was labeled with spectrum red deoxyuridine triphosphate, and AIMS product of the other twin was labeled with spectrum green. The superimposition of twin chromosomes results in frequent yellow coloration if both the twins have methylation at the same position, whereas frequent red and green color is present if both the twins have different methylation marks. In the given picture, upper panel shows a superimposed chromosome 3 of a 3-year-old twin, whereas outcome of superimposition for chromosome 3 among 50-year-old twin are shown in the lower panel. 3-year-old twin has more common DNA methylation patterns as highlighted by frequent yellow color compared to 50-year-old twin that has more red and green color present. These 50-year-old twin were also found different for H3 and H4 acetylation status. The authors concluded from this analysis that the younger monozygotic twins share more commonalities in environment and lifestyle, and this displayed minimal DNA methylation changes in all the groups, whereas those who were older had different lifestyles and exposed to different environmental conditions had unevenly distributed DNA methylation events, that is hypermethylations and hypermethylation, throughout their chromosomes.